Okay, today I'll be talking a little bit about the sterilization process during this pandemic time and how, as a dental surgeon, we are maintaining our clinics because they are all open during this time. It has been a large number of months when the patients have been suffering, so you push through and you try to put up your service towards them. So ultimately we are bound to open up our chambers for the service and to help the people. So a lot of my friends and juniors, they have been asking what all things I'm doing and how am I protecting myself and preventing the spread of this COVID-19. So I'm gonna tell you what are the things that usually I'm doing. So first of all, when a patient enters, so the first thing that everybody should keep in mind is check the temperature. It's understandable that nowadays everybody is not showing active infection and temperature may not always come up elevated. That's okay. And but the thing is that we have to take the minimum precautions. It should not happen that we ignore a active fever, a condition, and we take up such type of patients. So this will not only this can actually affect us, but what is more important is it will spread in the community because in your clinic there might be other patients also who are coming up. So that's the first thing. And second, most important, which I should have placed it in the first case, that is while you are taking up any or you are providing any appointment, at that time take a brief travel history or history of fever or diarrhea or loss of perception of taste or smell, like hyposmia, anosmia, hypogeusia. Okay, these types of things are right now pretty important. See, we haven't established any proper protocol yet, but the Indian Dental Association and WHO, they are all trying to help us with whatever findings they are getting, whatever observations they are getting. So my suggestion is while you provide appointment, at that time only you can take a short history of the patient and judge whether the patient should be allowed in your chamber or not. In case it's possible, then try to restrict your practice in such a way that aerosol generation doesn't take place. Try to do ART, that is atraumatic restorations, as much as possible with using the hand instruments. Use as less possible, your air rotor or the micromotor. So all of these things, they generate a large amount of aerosol. But still, sometimes we need to use it. So what to do in those cases, I'll come to that part. So this is the first thing that you should, while providing appointment, you are, checking whether the patient is a good candidate for your chamber or not. Once the patient arrives at your chamber, so make sure that you are going for a temperature check for them. And second thing is, ask them to, cleanse their hands with a little bit of hand sanitizers because now it is the, trend of hand sanitizer going on and everybody should be using it unless and until we get any vaccine against this widely spreading COVID-19. Now, another thing that comes up is I always recommend everybody to all the surgeons to wear a full PPE because personal protection is very important. One patient is once meeting us, the surgeons, but as a surgeon, we are meeting so many patients, okay? So you are supposed to definitely wear a PPE, which should comprise of an overall gown. It should have a mask, okay, FFP2 or N95 mask. And in case you think that the masks are going a little bit costly sometimes, so my recommendation is first you wear the N95 mask, and on that you can wear this surgical mask. So what you can dispose of is this surgical mask, and you do not need to dispose the N95, you can reuse it. And after that, what you do is you wear a face shield. Okay, a proper face shield is very important. And after that, you know, wear some gloves completely, okay, and seal yourself up. So first thing is you should seal yourself up, and your any no body part should be in direct contact with the outer environment. Whenever you are not wearing your face shield, by any chance, if you don't have, or maybe you know it got damaged or something, keep goggles. Okay, so you know you will see this type of, I think goggles are available, so you should, you know, keep these types of goggles ready with you people. So this way you should take your own protection. Now once the patient comes up, okay, you can see, you know, behind me, if you look at the light of the chair, and if you look at the handle, so you will see that there is a polythene, there's a plastic, it's a plastic wrap. Okay, so these plastic wraps are easily available. So what I have done is I have wrapped all the things which will be coming in contact with the patient with these plastic wraps. So what happens is, once you are the patient is holding the armrest of the chair or anything, okay, those portion you can simply just take out those plastic wraps, you can dispose it, and your chair is good. Another reason why I wrap it with is that the chemicals that I will be using later on, which I will be telling you later on, so those chemicals I have observed that they don't go good with on all surfaces. So sometimes they put some marks, okay, sometimes they put some droplet marks, or discolorations, and all these things take place. So if you are using this plastic wrap, so I think whatever chemical you will be using, okay, you can spray the chemical on these plastics, or you can simply dispose the plastic. So that way your original equipment, instruments, the dental chair, everything is going to remain secured. Now once you are done with the patient, so you try, while doing the patient, we always try to maintain the sterilization. You should always autoclave your instrument, so that is not for coronavirus or anything, it's true for every time. So we actually autoclave it for every surgical and operative procedures. So you should do that, you should continue doing that. And once the patient leaves, okay, what you're supposed to do is you are supposed to wipe all the areas where patient was touching, or patient was sitting, or even patient was handling anything, anything, any place, any surface, be it table, chair, dental chair, okay, anything the patient was handling. You just try to spray sodium hypochlorite, okay, on that. So nowadays there are big jars, 5-liter jar of sodium hypochlorite available. It's a very good bleach, it's a very good oxidative agent. And you should apply, you should spray on these parts. And primarily, if you find that any sputum or saliva, any sort of contamination has taken place in any part, you must do it. Like in case, what I'm trying to say is that in case the patient came up clean, it was just a case of consultation, there was no spitting, and you understand that there was nothing splashed, okay, no saliva, no sputum, nothing. So maybe you can deal with a couple of 2-3 patients, but mind it, in case the patient has spit in the spittoon or something like that, you should immediately spray or clean it with the sodium hypochlorite solution. I am currently trying to practice this, that I am not allowing the patient to use the spittoon of the dental chair. I'm primarily using the suction, okay, which has got the disposable tips. So one patient, one tip, so there is less chances of spread, less chance of contamination. But in case sometimes patients, without asking, they directly spit onto that. So whenever they do it, mind it, you are supposed to wash it thoroughly with sodium hypochlorite. And another thing is, do not use sodium hypochlorite on your costly instruments, or actually any instrument, okay, or any electrical goods, any battery operated goods that we use, like your surgical loops, okay, or your maybe the X-ray machine, or all these things. Okay, do not try to use sodium hypochlorite over there. always use in these cases surface disinfectant, a regular surface disinfectant. Even your face shield, if you are using, you should go for a regular surface disinfectant. That you should do, because mistakenly I didn't have that much idea previously. I applied the hypochlorite on certain equipments, and the instruments completely got damaged. Okay. Some instruments, they have got some plating, some powdered coating are present over there. They are completely damaged. So do not use it. So you just cleanse it with a normal alcohol based this disinfectant, and after that you should directly autoclave it. So do not put hypochlorite in these places. Any place you find it sensitive to chemicals, corrosive might be, so do not use the hypochlorite. So once you are done with this, once you are done the cleansing and your clinical job is over, after that what you are supposed to do is you should have a sort of a fumigator, a fogging machine. Okay, and I recommend that over there you should use it contains actually peroxide, hydrogen peroxide, but I recommend that you use silver reinforced hydrogen peroxide. So I still remember that when I was studying, I was graduating at that time, my oral pathology HOD came up and said that one day when you can become a good doctor, a big shot doctor, so that day maybe you can afford to clean your chamber with a silver reinforced this hydrogen peroxide. So now I'm not a big shot, but now it is the need of the hour that we must use the silver reinforced hydrogen peroxide. So always remember that this hydrogen peroxide, when they're reinforced with silver and you are fumigating it, so they go on to the air and into the toughest corners they can reach, okay, since they're fumes, they're aerosol, and they can cling on to the membranes wherever they find any, maybe the bacterial membrane or anything, and they can make it precipitate. Once that precipitation takes place, you should allow it to go for settling down. Many people ask for the time, so I won't mention the time because I personally don't use any time. I just check whether the fumes have come down or not. So it takes around half an hour, 45 minutes to 1 hour time, depending upon how big your clinical establishment is. So once it has settled down, after that what you do is again take sodium hypochlorite, okay, and you should put some drops of sodium hypochlorite in the water, okay, in the tumbler, okay, and then you are supposed to mop the floor thoroughly, rigorously, okay, not only your operating room but also the waiting lounge, whatever is present, the waiting area for the patient, all those things, okay. And after that, while you are removing the PPE, take proper precaution that every time you are touching any exposed surface of the PPE, okay, you are supposed to clean your, wipe your hand, okay. Remember, soap is always better, soap water is always the best actually, but every time, like, you cannot go for a washing your hand, so what you should do is you should go for the hand sanitizer. And one more thing I forgot to tell you, that what I do personally, it's like my personal opinion, that when I wear a PPE, so I have got one surgical gloves, I wear it, and per patient I'm going to wear one more gloves, okay, because you see, once one patient leaves, okay, what happens is you are supposed to, you need to touch a lot of areas, so you don't do that just wearing the same gloves, okay. You first dispose your gloves. And instead of using bare hand in my clinic, I do not nowadays putting the bare hand on any surface on the clinic. That gloves actually keeps me protected for the entire period of time, as long as I'm in the chamber. Before I forget, I must also mention that try to switch off your AC if possible, put on the fan, okay, open the windows if these are possible. If it is not possible, then I think there are some artificial system, the vacuum system and the purifiers are available, so you have to use them. But in my chamber I have got a wide window, and I just open it up and put on the fan, because ventilation is very important. Even if the virus is coming up, you need to make sure that they get diluted in your air, they should not be concentrated over there. So because see, virus will enter in, maybe virus is entering our body, but we are safe as long as the concentration, the you know, the count of the viral or the viral load is not going into that critical level. So you know, no AC, proper ventilation, okay, windows open and fans should be on. So do this thing, and do this thing for the in the patient's area also. And once you are done with the chamber, okay, you should just mop it, mop all the surfaces, whatever you see, all the surfaces, and only then you are you know, good to go. So you know, while you are going to you know, remove your PPE, what you're supposed to do is, you know, take the PPE and everything, whatever was in contact with the patient, in case there are some patient drapes or anything like that. Your even for me, it is even the N95 mask. Okay, all these things, what I do is I put it in a, you know, tumbler full of water, and I mix it with again sodium hypochlorite, and I let it soak over there for a couple of minutes, okay, maybe 10-15 minutes, even sometimes more also. I leave it just like that, okay. And you can also, you know, spray in the dustbin that you're using, and spray, or you can pour some, you know, dip it in the sodium hypochlorite. Because once you are, you know, treating it with sodium hypochlorite, hopefully you can use it as a regular, you know, regular what do you say, garbage. I personally always try to take this precaution that you should always put the sodium hypochlorite in that dustbin. That is number one thing. Number two thing is I soak all my, you know, clothes, the scrub, everything whatever is present, you know, for a minute or so, or at least, you know, 5-10 minutes, 15 minutes in sodium hypochlorite, diluted of course. And once it is soaked, after that, you know, I'm going to transfer it to a detergent based liquid, okay, like a regular detergent powder water mixture, and then I go for washing of it, and then I take a nice shower, and only then I consider myself that I'm acceptable in the, you know, society, or at least with my family. Okay, these are the safest procedures that we can do. I know, you know, like sterilization is such a thing, cleanliness is such a thing, that however you do, however I tell, maybe, you know, even I'm also missing out something. So in case I'm missing out something, please do write it in the comment section, and tell me if these things, these suggestions help you or not. Okay, so for the time being, you know, I'll be stopping over here. Okay, see you later. Jai Hind.